Welcome to another session of Soilworks Soil Solutions. We're lucky enough to have the doctor of the refractometer, the commander of the sugar, the PhD of insects, bugs, and all things good and bad, Dr. Thomas Dykstra. Thank you for being here. And we're going to jump right into it, if you're okay with that, even if you're not okay with it.
Even if I'm not okay, we're just going to jump right into it. So
the gals in the office are saying they're getting a lot of phone calls about earthworms in soil.
Okay.
Earthworms, angleworms, night crawlers. Does that fit into the entomology world?
No, but it fits into fishing really well.
Thank you.
Yeah. Oh, entomology. I'm sorry. We're going in a very different direction than fishing.
Yes.
I understand.
So with these worms, what I have seen and learned many years ago is the most efficient digesters in any environment are beneficial fungi and beneficial microbes and all the good things that a good environment brings.
That is correct. That is correct.
What I've also seen is if the environment gets a little bit tough,
yes,
possibly chemically, possibly pressure, possibly not enough food, not enough carbon, oxygen, hydrogen, not enough electricity, those beneficial, I'm going to call them the beneficial microbes and the fungi, the cooks of the kitchen, the preparers of food, they go dormant, they spore off, or they just become inactive.
They do. They do.
And what we found is, and all of a sudden now you get earthworms, angleworms, night crawlers moving in.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of farmers are saying, man, we've got so many worms in our soil, it's fantastic. But what if those worms are up towards the surface of the soil? Is that a good or a bad thing? And before I got to do one more thing. So the best digesters are microscopic.
No doubt.
The second best digesters are the earthworms, angleworms, night crawlers.
Mm-hmm.
If the soil degrades, the animals or the critters show up to deal with it. The bottom level is a lower level of worms, the army worms, wire worms, root worms, cut worms, pick your critter.
Actually insects, but keep going. You're doing great.
Critters that are trying to snip off the roots or feed on the roots to rebuild the soil. So depending on which way the soil is moving, if it's going down or improving coming up, earthworms
have their place.
Yes.
Yes.
Are they the end-all, do-all? Hey, we've reached utopia.
They cannot be the end-all, utopia, endgame, because all of the plants that I've had to take a look at, and we're usually dealing with high earthworm activity, are not a high enough BRIX. And so, therefore, I would then say that we're... Oh, no, yeah. Do I have to define BRIX again?
No. But say that again.
Sure. The earthworms are not attacking plants of very high BRIX. If they were, that means the high BRIX plants would be in high BRIX soil, healthy soil, and therefore the earthworms are found in healthy soil. Where you find the healthiest plants, you don't find very many earthworms or night crawlers or some of the other...
Angles? Fishing worms?
Wrigglers?
Can of worms. Are they deeper down?
Yeah.
Where are they?
They're going to go as wherever there's food. So wherever there's food, they will take it to that point. They need to be comfortable. They need to be able to breathe. They're not going to be able to go that deep if there's compaction. Therefore, they are going to be close to the surface. So if you do have compaction, it's a very high level. The earthworms, generally speaking, are going to have difficulty getting down low. If they can get through the compaction layer, then they will, and they will form their tunnels and then pull down some of the pre-digested food sources that they like to consume, even though it's not necessarily all about the plants, because predominantly they are bacterial feeders, as are the nematodes too. And so they're really going after the bacteria, meaning you've got to have a lot of bacteria on a plant part that is going to get pulled down. In other words, it's being digested, and that is actually what is very attractive to earthworms. This is why, very simply, we don't see millions of earthworms rise up and attack a corn plant. They just don't do that. They're in the soil, and that's what they do, but they're not attacking plants on top of the surface. They're only pulling it down. The reason why they pull it down is because the bacteria that you just mentioned at the beginning of this very eloquent introduction that you made, you're welcome. I'm just
moving on.
Moving on. And so because of that, there are going to be a lot more microbes in the soil, which are going to assist in the digestion, which is what the earthworms need, because they have that digestive system working. So if you are supplying a lot of food, a buffet for the earthworms, their numbers will increase drastically because you have given them the food that they need. But because these earthworms are not associated with high BRIX plants, 12 to 14 and above, I can assume then that what they were doing is very similar to weeds. They're trying to increase the health of the soil. They do a very good job at increasing the health of the soil. Once the soil is healthy enough, their numbers decrease. They usually don't go down to zero, but their numbers will decrease because there's not as much of a food source for them anymore, because this is, again, what they eat. So I get that part. Having said that, this also is a little bit of a segue, even though you didn't ask me the question, but I'm just going to go in that direction anyway.
You read my mind.
Almost like I read your mind.
That good.
Because, yeah, slugs are kind of doing the same thing. So slugs have a tendency, they're only able to eat soft tissue. They're not able to eat hard tissue. You don't see slugs moving up and down hard, tough plants. Anytime you see them on a plant, they're going after the soft part of the plant, something that has already started to degrade or decompose.
Rot.
Rot is a great monosyllabic word. See, I love that.
See, I can understand rotting. Rotting isn't something healthy, so something healthy probably wouldn't be high BRIX.
Probably wouldn't be. So
on it.
That is a great word. So rotting is probably well understood by our viewers too. You seem to be connecting with them very well. I, on the other hand, am struggling. So I thank you.
I'm a little slow, but I'm consistent.
I'll take consistent.
Moving on.
And so the slugs, what they are going to do is they are looking for plant tissue that is also partially digested. This is partly why they go after very, very soft food. So it can be a plant that maybe was hard at one time, but it's now soft. And the slugs will come in and eat it. And this is why you often see them associated with a no-till program where they're simply taking the plants, running them over, crimping them down. And all of this food source can be eaten by slugs. And so many individuals that I've talked to said, I've never had slugs on my property, ever. And I've been doing this for decades. I switched to no-till, boom, the slugs appeared. And that's because a food source has been provided for the slugs. You know, if you feed them, they will come type of thing. And so that's why they suddenly appeared. If you don't have that food source for them, then you're not going to see them because there's no food for them to eat and they're going to die off. That's where the microbes come in, because most of the digestion is going to occur underneath the soil, as I alluded to with the earthworms. And so when you take the plant matter and place it underneath the soil, it doesn't even have to be that deep, it starts to decompose. Mm-hmm. And it's the microbes that are starting to decompose it. And so that means you can have about, give or take, 100% of the plant material digested underneath the soil. You cannot do that if the plant is on the surface. You never get 100% digestion on the surface, because the sun will oxidize.
That oxidizes?
It's the oxidizing thing, yeah.
Oh, well, what could be lost by the infrared, the ultraviolet rays of the sun through, let's just say, 3 or 4 months? The sun never fades the paint on a piece of equipment or a tractor. How possibly could the sun oxidize carbon out of the residue?
Yeah, it gets even better than that, because it's not just the carbon, but the sun, which is, it's a hot, fiery ball in the middle of our solar
burning
system.
Burning fireball.
It burns, and therefore a lot of the moisture comes off. And when you don't have moisture, the microbes don't work well. It doesn't digest that well anymore. This is part of the reason why putting it just underneath the surface will allow the moisture to stay and the microbes will work, because they do need some moisture. When you have it on the surface, it dries out. There's nothing left and the microbes can't break it down. You have to depend upon, in some cases, slugs or earthworms if they are able to take it down. And if they are not, and some of you know what I'm talking about, some of the plant matter that is left on your field will be there the next season and even two seasons away, because it is not breaking down. It is not decomposing. And that's not the idea. The idea is to have things decompose so that they enter the carbon cycle.
So help me out here.
Be happy to.
I don't think I'm the only one thinking this. So earthworms in any soil, doesn't matter what the tillage is, we're not picking on anybody.
Sure.
Earthworms in any soil towards the surface, on one side could be viewed very beneficially.
It could be, yeah.
But on the other side, there's a problem because they're here.
That could also be viewed too, depending upon where you are, where your soil is. Now, obviously, a lot of us know that earthworms on the surface occur after a rain. That's because if you get a big rain, everything gets kind of flooded. Their tunnels are flooded. They come up, and it's very common for us to see that. There are other cases where the worms are going to be close to the surface too, not necessarily related to rain, but because the compaction layer is a little difficult to get through, or they simply are just looking for plant matter in order to bring down into the soil in order to start to digest it.
A lot of the golf courses that we work with do not appreciate worms on the tee boxes or the greens.
Why is that?
They're uppity. And so we've gotten a lot of calls over the years, and we've done a lot of work with golf courses, and it's just like, you've got a compaction layer, and the reason that those worms are coming up after a rain or after an irrigation is because you're grounding them. They have no air. And they look at me like I've got the proverbial horn on my forehead, and it's like, put down some calcium.
Yeah.
Our calcium, specially formulated for this. If it doesn't work, I'll write you a check back. Haven't written one back yet. I'm sure that's coincidence, but the thing is, if those worms, the closer they are to the surface, would you say there may be a compaction problem?
Well, there would be if most of them are there. Of course, you'd have to do a little bit of digging to find out. We could have a lot of worms at the surface, but we could also have 95% of them underneath the surface too. So to be fair, it would be a good idea to see how deep they are going. However, without a shovel, there are some conclusions that might be drawn, and yours is one of them, is that we might be dealing with a compaction layer.
Well, an interpretation.
Yeah.
So let's say the earthworms are the ambulance. You see an ambulance roll up in front of your house, and it's like, oh, somebody's having a tough day. But the other side, oh, what a great thing the ambulance is there is to take them to the hospital.
Sure.
And these feelings keep going, and then you find out that the ambulance is for you, and you don't realize you're bleeding out of every orifice. It's like mixed feelings.
Mm-hmm.
However you interpret this, this is nothing but a sign, a signal, an indicator. So when you see one thing, please don't just automatically go, oh, this is what it is, good, bad, or indifferent. Look deeper. My old professor would say, look for the cause, behind the cause, behind the cause. Rather than reacting to symptoms, Sugar Daddy Dykstra measures the sugar content, the judge, the equalizer, the evaluator of the health of the crop. If you're curious about more information about earthworms, microbes, insects, BRIX of the sugar content of a plant, Dr. Dykstra can give you some information on where to get that.
Well, I don't have all of those videos up online yet.
Well, focus up, pal.
Okay. All right. So there are a few videos online. If you're interested in learning more about BRIX, you can find me on Thomas Dykstra on YouTube. A quick search will get you that. And we're hoping to add maybe a few more videos, especially because I'm being forced to against my will by Mr. Rabenberg. And
if he doesn't put out, start putting some pressure on him. We expect a little more out of him.
They do expect a lot of more out of me. And so these are, this is what I have to put up with. I hope you feel my pain, don't you? You feel my pain?
Oh, look at the time. For Dr. Dykstra and myself at SoilWorks, we appreciate you tuning in. We hope the information has been valuable. Thank you.
Thank you.